It's nice to be here, and it's very nice to see all of you here as well. And I guess between BA and BR, it's amazing any of us made it here. But it's a testament to how, I guess, transporting electronically is becoming in many ways more reliable than physically. But so goes it. So today, I suppose, really the aim that I have is to hope we can start a good discussion about how we unlock knowledge assets. There's no question that we have collectively acquired, particularly over the last decade, a fantastic resource of knowledge assets in all respects. The question I think that we need to address is how we unlock those, which involves also collimating what assets we ourselves as humans interact with. And that leads me to what I think is the main theme that really we need to bring out, which is the idea that available knowledge, things that just are there notionally, in principle, that one could access, is a quite different phenomenon from what I would call democratized knowledge, where you as an average citizen can actually yourself, in practical terms, use that knowledge every day in the way that you'd like to. And so that distinction, which is often blurred, and particularly by governments, I think is a very important one to keep in mind as we go through, and where computers can indeed bridge that gap. So that's why this somewhat experimental conference, we've tried to sort of mix a discussion of the perspective. What information do we really want to be able to get in our hands as individuals or as experts even? What is it that we would like to try and understand about the information that's out there? So we'd like to mix that with, you know, a real understanding for what the technology can deliver at this point and into the future. You know, how do we, you know, what is it? Because often I think these things are talked about by rather different groups of people. So we end up with people who know about the knowledge they'd like to see, but then they don't really know what technology could deliver, and somewhat vice versa as well. Well, in a sense, we can say now that computation, I would say, has come of age. So it would seem strange to most people here, the idea that you couldn't compute things. But actually, in history, it's relatively recent, the idea that you can compute logically definite results. It's certainly in the sort of a swathe of human history. What I think we're now in an era starting is that we have high-powered computation that is available for everyone. We have that ability in a way that has never existed before in human history. And we need to understand exactly what that really means for life and knowledge and expertise and all the other things that go with it. So I think, you know, some of the things I listed here, you know, who can process information and compute answers? That's a big change. You know, in the past, any sort of high-level computation has had to be done by an expert, and that rather limits who's possible. Another very interesting thing is what publishing information actually constitutes. For, you know, several hundred years by this point, the publishing information has had a rather fixed style. Yes, it's evolved. It's got fancier graphs and graphics and things like this, but it's been a very one-way street. And I think that's changing, and we need to understand how that publishing fits. Also, where the value really lies in what I call the supply chain of knowledge. Which aspect of getting it from collecting the basic data to useful information that people actually have at their fingertips, which aspect of that is the most valuable in the modern economy? And, you know, I'm then going to go loop back as to, you know, given that, what do humans really need to learn? How does that change in the future? It's not obvious that what we're being taught, particularly in technical education, is in fact the right thing, given what we can now do with computers. Well, I always believe in, you know, actually looking at what one's talking about a little bit. So let me try and show you some sort of immediate examples of how, in a sense, you can use computers with computation to get at knowledge. So what I'm going to do is to pull up a browser here, and I will go to our Wolfram Alpha site. And if I can type it in properly, which I have not, and I should have just gone to the app, actually, which is at the side. made the mistake of recently getting a new computer, which is a thing that I try to avoid doing because of all the things that you need to change over. So when people think about math and computation, what they think about is, you know, things where you type, you know, high-powered equations in and you get results that you might expect from that. So there's an integral, right? So people would think of that as math. And it's sort of unsurprising, I suppose, that, so I asked sort of in a rough way for the integration of sine x. But I think what people would, in a sense, you know, less think of as sort of being straight math would be to ask for, let's say, the EU health spending. EU health spending per person. So, you know, what's happened there is we're doing a whole bunch of collecting together a bunch of different things, pulling data in, and we're asking a very specific question. It's had to understand about European Union expenditure on health per capita, all sectors, et cetera, and it's come up then with that, and it's found a way to visualize that result and give us some sort of indications that it thinks are useful in a sense of that visualization. So that's a typical kind of thing you can do by linguistically querying knowledge and computations with computation. Yeah? Well, let me come on to that a little bit, because that's to do somewhat with, in a sense, how you... there are many different layers to that question. So I think the question is, you know, how can you provide feedback and sort of somehow hone the results, I think, is somewhat the question. And I'll try and show you, actually. Let me show you a part of the answer to that question in just a second with another example. Let's do something perhaps somewhat topical of asking for, like, Exxon versus BP. We can look at, hopefully, the latest characteristics of those companies. Now, I'm not an expert on analyzing companies, so one of the things that's important here is to get some idea of what to compare in those situations. You can see there, and there's a chart which I guess, yes, that's right, the redder line here is BP, which has fallen rather dramatically. I guess we could, now here, in a sense, the refinement question a little bit comes in, because we've got here, we could say, well, let's go for the last month rather than the last year, and we get a chart which is specific to that area. So, yes, I mean, there are starting ways to be able to do that. And what's really happened here is we've built a little application in real time to make this work. But it's all generated from this sort of easy linguistic query. We could also do something like ask for a BMI of a 39-year-old. And there we get a 39-year-old. And unfortunately, this is the last day that I can start my age with a 3. So... there we go. And I guess I don't quite know what my weight actually is, but I know my height is a little greater than that. So I can now adjust this, and we can hopefully see down below how I fit into the chart of BMIs as a sort of medical query on my state. I think I must be rather heavier than that, because I don't think I normally fit into the normal range. But anyway, this is what's interesting here is it's personalized to me. This may be a question specifically that nobody's asked in exactly this way. The data's out there in some sense, but it's being pieced together with computation. Okay, well, that's in a sense. Let me go back sort of to other kinds of access as well as sort of linguistic access. That was an example of how linguistic access can work with computation to bring you results. So here's another example where computation works, which is kind of more at the quotes reader end. So here's a little piece of research, essentially, that's been produced on tax rates and how they affect income for a government. And I'm not an economist, but I suspect, unfortunately, this is a chart all of us in the UK will be looking at a little bit more as time progresses. But the idea is, as you change this, we see effects in the output of the results. And I think this bar here is what the government is actually getting, and then there are different characteristics of the so-called income and leisure utility exponents and how that changes changes what happens with these marginal rates of tax. So what's exciting here to me is, you know, you could have 10 charts here with some wording between, but actually with this and a little bit of description, you have a much sort of higher ability to be able to conceptualize some of the things that are going on, particularly when you drive yourself. I find that makes a big difference. Okay, so, okay, that's a good question. So in the particular layout of this, there is, you can go behind it and see which model is being run. Now, of course, what somebody, you know, so there's a big question there of, there's the technology that allows that to happen, and then there's whether people individually want to use that facility. But one of the things I think is very important is to be able to contain all the information about how to generate whatever you're doing as much as possible with the information that's there. And I think that's been one of the issues with recent scientific output often, that that has not happened for reasons that are not really necessary anymore given the technology we have.
I didn't understand that. I think you'd be a lunatic to present those numbers without understanding how they were calculated, what the model was designed.
Right, actually, I'm going to tell you what happened. There was a model sitting here, and because I increased the font size a little bit, I think it's become, there was actually an expression here that laid that out, and I will try and get back to that, and that expression should tell you. But in the end, my point about that I was just making was, as an author, I might decide to include that or not include it. Now, as an author, I would like to include that, and I tried to include it here. Somewhat failed. But I think, you know, you've got to distinguish what technology allows to happen and what people end up actually doing in that respect. But I completely agree that, yes, you need to understand something about the model. I want to come back to that question of what you as a human need to understand versus the computer and what you can kind of think about that. So another sort of area where computation can help us access and connect with information, I think, is, you know, on the end of the authoring. Because one of the problems, one of the reasons we don't see a lot of interactivity is because it's hard to author things which work. You know, it's become rather easy to author things like charts, but it's rather hard to author things like programs. So as a simple example, we have a forthcoming widget builder, so-called, which allows us just to put up, this is my website, I put up a little blog post last night, and this, I included this widget which allows me to take oil production, seem to be in an oil theme today, or energy production, and compare it to, let's say, oil consumption. Maybe that's not actually what I was meaning to do, some slightly different comparison, but never mind. But you can see the point here that we've generated a result. And this has been very easy to author. This is not something where it took a long time to do. This was a throwaway kind of thing, like you might make a chart in a traditional Excel or something like that. This is the kind of level of speed in which you can now, and which we're working towards trying to make it so that you can build things. So that's a really important aspect, using computation to help you build interactivity, so to speak, on the fly. Okay, let me come to another topic that is sort of an important topic in this thing, which is the answers, not search, as I call it. So obviously over the last, 10 plus years, the web, and in particular searching the web, has become a sort of extremely important aspect of getting knowledge. And often I've been recently invited onto panels and so forth to discuss what people call the future of search. But as I point out to people, that isn't the real question. The question is the future of answers. What you actually care about is how to get the right answer for you. Search is a process, and it has been extremely successful in certain aspects of getting the right kind of answer, but it's only one process. And of course, the process that we've been working on hard is a computational process, which generates a whole slew of different kinds of answers, and I think can get you potentially quite a bit further on many of them. So I've often sort of used a chart a little bit like this. You can pick many holes in what's written here, but I think as a rough idea, you know, you can think of systematic knowledge as facts, method, and interpretation. Obviously an oversimplification. And if you think about what search is doing, in a sense, the computer is pulling the straight facts. Now, of course, I put facts in quotes, right? We all know that you can get false facts, so to speak. But it's pulling the base knowledge, I suppose you could call it. And in a sense, you as the human are expected to process that fact, curate them, use the method, interpret the results. So that's sort of been where we've mostly been at with search. With computational knowledge, we're trying to get the computer to have the automation to process those results, in many cases specifically for you. And, you know, for you to then perhaps even have the computer help with the interpretation. That's another whole issue about to what extent you editorialize what you're doing with the computer. But that's a sort of many answers that you actually want, in my view, in the systematic end of knowledge, mix sort of knowledge and computation in this way. And I think that's this very powerful idea that really has only existed since Wolfram Alpha sort of came out a year ago in the sense, in this sort of democratized sense. So what are the technical ingredients you really need for democratization? How do you really get knowledge in everyone's hands, and what technically are the sort of the things that you really need to achieve that? So one thing that you clearly need at all levels is a good interface. You know, I cannot overemphasize the need to have, you know, the interface makes the difference between something that's usable in practice and something that's not usable, however powerful it is under the surface. I mean, if you look at recent modern technology, the iPhone, for example, is a good example where, you know, the technology physically was all around before, but actually plugging it together and giving it a good interface and a good process has made a massive difference. And that interface has to be, you know, both for sort of immediate drive-by stuff, like I was doing, authoring and reading, but reading in a sort of interactive sense. And underlying that, you really need automation at all levels. You need to somehow figure out how do you split methods from tasks. Now, this is a contentious issue, which I think perhaps was the subject of the earlier question. And I think one needs to think very carefully about this and how one, particularly how one trains people to use those tools and corroborate the answers. But I think the idea that somehow you should know all the methods that you always use for everything cannot succeed in the long term. I think it's very important to understand that, and it doesn't succeed in things that we're used to using every day. That is not an idea that succeeds. When I use my computer, I do not understand the details of how the inside of my computer works. I'm very separated from the details inside the chips of the computer. When I drive my car, same thing. That concept also applies for knowledge, but we've got to be very careful how we use that. Obviously, also computational power. You've got to actually be able to do the computations. And also knowledge that is susceptible to computation, that you can apply computation to, that in some sense, you know, is systematized in the right way and laid out in the right way. And when we've applied that to Wolfram Alpha, you know, we've roughly got these sort of pillars that it relies on: linguistic analysis, curated data. This is very out of date. It's more like 20 or 30 trillion pieces of data right now that we have in Wolfram Alpha. And I should get this updated. Some of those dynamic. One of the parts I think that people don't realize is important is computed presentation. So the idea that, you know, you actually have to make a new presentation in real time after you've queried something is kind of a very important part and concept of what you need to do to present knowledge. So I thought I would just spend a couple of minutes explaining how we at Wolfram Research and Wolfram Alpha thing got into this whole business. We've built Mathematica, our computational software, since 1988 when it was released. We've been trying to build something that computes and visualizes, develops, allows you to develop things, and documents and deploys. Basically allows people who are technical people to work with it. Now, here's the interesting thing, and how do we get from there to a sort of democratized access to knowledge? Well, one thing we did was we injected knowledge into the computation. So that's certainly one change that's happened. But there is a thread that's sort of very interesting that runs through the process we've taken. Because in a sense, all the way through, we've been trying to automate the methods, so that people could access certain tasks. So, for example, for solving a differential equation, the original idea was you needed to know exactly which method you were using at each point in time. But now you can get a computer to automate that better than almost any human could do it and get answers that are more accurate. But that's obviously for technical experts. The jump also comes moving that out to people who are not, would not consider themselves technical experts. But at the same time, over the last 20 plus years, the world has changed quite dramatically. People are far more technical than they ever used to be. The world is far more technical. So in a sense, we've kind of met this change in the world where people are now, even in everyday life, you know, you look at a mortgage or you look at government statistics, people are expected to understand these at a much higher level of sort of quantitative understanding. They're expected to, I'm not saying they do, but they're expected to, than they were expected to 20 years ago, for example. So it's been a kind of interesting journey to watch us automate computation more and the world become more kind of in need of computation that works. So I wanted to think a bit about the knowledge ecosystem, as I call it, and what will happen in future as against what's happened now. So one of the big questions is, in the future, who provides the knowledge assets? You know, where do the base knowledge assets come from, and who kind of provides those? And who are the new users of those? You know, in practice, are all citizens using this effectively? Another big question, which I think in particular governments haven't quite understood yet, is who really curates the information? We have, many governments have very, services that collect in great detail much government statistics. But then there's a question of taking that from, as I said at the beginning, the available to the accessible. And that's quite a big gap. That's not a trivial thing, to take it from what some expert could dig into with many hours to spend and a citizen can really access to what they need. Who pays for that? How does that work? Who's in charge of that? Then there's a question of injecting expertise. Now, when I did some of those queries earlier, one of the things was, what kind of answers to produce? You know, if we're comparing BP and Exxon, there are hundreds of parameters we could choose to put out. Which ones did we present first? And who's in control of that? And how do we editorialize that? So there's this sort of idea that you need to inject human expertise into what kind of outputs you're interested in seeing. And that's another area that I think is an important sort of... So far from believing that somehow experts are redundant, I think it's quite the opposite, that they're kind of multiplied up. And, you know, in what form do we monetize these results? And if you see, there have already been, of course, big consequences to this. If you look at the media, particularly the print media, you know, the print media goes online. They just stick everything online, and surprise, surprise, the value of base knowledge has rather gone down. And so then there's problems monetizing that. On the other hand, you know, if you think about interactions between readers and authors and how you can make that a much richer experience, and some of the things I've been talking about, you know, that changes what you might think about as the possible monetization. And that leads me to, you know, how will authors and readers interact in the future? This is massively in need of an overhaul. I mean, it is... it is surprising that more overhaul hasn't already happened in that direction.
Conrad, before you go on, can you go back to the first one, the knowledge assets?
Yeah.
What are you defining as knowledge assets? Is that pure data, or are you going on to methods of analyzing data?
Yes, that's a very good point. So both. I think knowledge assets, I mean, most people, most of the time, I think what they would be sort of putting in that bucket would be, yeah, the base knowledge, the base data, if you like. But I completely agree with you that another aspect here are, in a sense, the methods that you use to operate on that data. And I think it's a very good point that possibly I should split those, actually, as being separate issues. You know, there are, so to speak, you know, in mathematical terms, the algorithms, but it might not just be the algorithms, it might be, you know, a particular way of analyzing data that it's really important to think of as a separate asset. And, you know, the knowledge that contains. Now, the question right now is typically what's happened is, you know, experts have contributed that knowledge sort of manually in a particular case. The question is whether we can now automate that contribution in some sense. But it's certainly an asset in its own right. Let me come on to that actually a little bit, because what I was going to do was just quickly summarize a few of the areas where I think we have knowledge assets and sort of what the... you know, what the deal with that is, in a sense, as I see it at the moment and where it should go. So, you know, let's look at people who have huge amounts of knowledge and data. Governments, obviously, are high on this list. And I'm pleased to say, and, you know, the UK is doing well on this front, finally, that it is good to see, you know, the idea that governments should release the data that they collected on everything that we paid for, etc. I think that is a very good progress. The idea, I think, was only, what, 2 years ago that they wanted to sell the data back to us in the UK. And I think that that turnaround, which has been led by a range of people, and particularly Tim Berners-Lee and The Guardian, things has been a very positive direction. However, if you truly want to democratize knowledge, that means open and usable, and we ain't there yet. We've just dumped a bunch of knowledge out. It's a great start, and we have much more to do, but we've got to think much, much more about in what form that happens. And one point I should make, particularly in the current position that we're in, and massive efficiency gains needed, et cetera, in government, is the biggest single users of government data right now are governments. So if you can make data more efficient to access, you immediately have a great benefit for governments themselves internally. Now, of course, Cameron has many times, even since he was elected, pointed out that he wants to try and get citizens to kind of check up on the government by releasing data on the government and hoping that citizens will essentially help to manage the government that way. I think that's an interesting plan, particularly if you spell government right. But in order to do that effectively, it's quite clear that you need citizens actually be able to access that in an appropriate way. And if they can't, in practical terms, access that, then you're not going to be able to get them to have that effect. And even if you have to, and I was watching the coins data that's recently been released. Now, it's great that it's been released, but in the end, I'm sure in the media and so forth. I was at The Guardian recently, and they were having groups of people sitting around trying to get to some part of that data and understand what does any of this mean. It's out it comes as CSV files. A good start, but we got an awfully long way to go to realize, I believe, what the Cameron government, the coalition government, wants to achieve with having citizens hold the government to account. Another area of government funding is R&D. And I reckon, on a quick tot up around the world, about $300 billion is spent on R&D. And I slightly provocatively ask, what's the output? And what I really mean by that is, what's the form of the output? Now, traditionally, in a sense, it's scientific papers, which I guess were started a few roads away at the Royal Society some few hundred years ago. It's insane that this is the basic style of output of technical communication these days. It just doesn't make any sense. They're low bandwidth. What I mean by that is the communication between the author and the reader are, that there's a very thin pipe between those. And that's completely unnecessary in the modern world. So one of the things we've been working on hard is to think of how you can connect documents and applications. I see documents and applications as two sides of the same coin. But when you talk to people who are involved in documents, like publishers, they have a completely different vocabulary and style of thinking about that than if you talk to people who are involved in applications, who are typically programmers and software companies. But actually, as you merge these two, you find there's a lot more in common between them than you might think. And I guess what I believe is that whichever form of the terminology one uses, you can get a long way by publishing results as applications, in a sense, in scrolling documents, if that's the terminology, or as interactive documents, whichever way you want to talk about that. And that many of the things we've recently seen, for example, with some of the environmental issues, if you had stuff to play with, if the reader can drive, if you can uncover the data underneath that, if you can do your own tests on it, because it's all there in a form that can be easily used, that improves greatly the use of these knowledge assets. Well, another thing that we've had extreme interest in is sort of corporate information and what I would call drive-by answers that are hard to get from traditional business systems. Traditionally in a business, you want to get your sales figures, so you get a big report out of sales figures, let's say. But if you want to ask, what were sales in Spain last month? Right, you've got to go down some report or get something to generate something. What you should be able to do is type this in, right? I want to know the Spanish sales figures for the last month and linguistically query that. So there's been, I think there's tremendous knowledge assets to be unlocked inside sort of private assets that are not for public consumption, but are sort of for internal democratization, in a sense, in organizations. And as we touched on a bit earlier, the role of human experts. You know, I don't know why I think of this comparison, but it's a bit like, I suppose, before the era of mass media and television and so forth and movies, actors kind of could play to a particular stage individually and a relatively small audience. And suddenly they could then, you know, appear and be multiplied out many, many times in their acting, and that going to a much, much wider audience at once. Well, so I think it is with sort of human experts feeding automation that's underneath what you can supply through computers. So sort of instead of direct expertise delivered to the individual sort of face-to-face, the expertise is somehow encoded. But there's no question that sort of human expertise is a really crucial part. And I think we diverge in our thinking somewhat from maybe some of the traditional search engines, for example, where the idea is you can somehow do it all by computer algorithms purely. And I'm not sure I completely agree with that. And finally, one of the things that I think needs to change, and I have a talk on this later today, is our education for this new era. That's somewhat paradoxical, what I'm saying here, because in a sense I'm saying, we should get computers to get stuff automated so that you, even if you aren't specially educated, can somehow use those computers to get the knowledge working for you. And I am saying that. But I'm then looping back around and saying, given that that's the case, I think we can dramatically change, particularly maths education and things around maths, to improve people's ability to be able to drive that automation and that machinery and for much better benefits, and actually for more interest for themselves as well. So I'm not going to go on about that now, because I can spend a long time going on about that topic. But I suppose one of the pivotal questions to think about, is it cheating to use Wolfram Alpha or some maths engine for maths homework? It's a sort of interesting question, because as I'll leave you to ponder that perhaps a little bit as we go through. Well, I'd like to summarize and talk through a few of these things, in particular what I'm meaning by this computational knowledge economy terminology. So the web has done a tremendous job of, in a very short space of time, of democratizing sort of base information retrieval. I mean, it is quite extraordinary how much one depends upon that in the web. And it's not so long ago that, anybody who's under about... 10 years old or 15 years old now, it just seems incredible that one couldn't just access these things immediately. The challenge, as I've tried to explain, is in democratizing this application of systematic knowledge, not the base knowledge itself. So we've got to make knowledge not just available but accessible, and I think part of that is making it computational where that's possible. And semantic, people ask, how does the semantic web fit into this? I think semantic web is a good, it takes you to some structuring, but it isn't enough to allow you to compute results from it. So it's sort of more organized and attaches meaning, but I would sort of say computational is one step kind of further, in a sense, than that. And we need to think, about this, where the future added value actually is. Years ago, it was in base knowledge. Somebody actually just got the basic information. That was really worth a lot of money. Then it became that delivering that knowledge has become cheaper and cheaper, and so the delivery of that knowledge was originally expensive to do, and so people would pay for that. Now, that's very cheap, and the collection of it is really quite cheap, too, in many cases, though, of course, not necessarily the checking and the accuracy of it. So there are many issues up this sort of value chain of knowledge that we need to think about, and I think a lot of the added value in the future will be applying this technology to get results that you really want and thinking of the problems and questions that really need to be asked there. So when I think about, what's often termed as, in a sense, the knowledge economy, I think that perhaps what people... It seems to have several definitions that are slightly discrepant. But it appears to me that knowledge economy, at some level, is where a large fraction of the population is somehow generating wealth through knowledge, the application of knowledge, rather than necessarily, physically making things. or just the physical mechanics of making things. Of course, you could physically make things and use knowledge and apply that, of course, too. So I think we're entering an era where that base knowledge is not what's the most valuable. It's the application of, so to speak, this computational knowledge that's most valuable. And right now, we're at a stage where there are relatively few people in society who can use that expertise. That computation is very much locked into a rather small group who are sort of highly trained for that expertise. And I think in future, the reason I call it the computational knowledge economy is I think we have an ability to massively increase who can use that sort of high-level knowledge, a high-level application of knowledge. And it will be exciting to see how that changes the value chain as we move forward. Thanks very much. I just want to check on our status of technology.
I think we have a speaker.
Great, okay. Let me, while John, I think, is setting that up, maybe I'll take a couple of questions. There'll be chance for questions all the way through, but let me let them organize the technology, hopefully. And meanwhile, I'll try and see whether we can have some comments and questions. Go ahead.
I've got a question which is about framing what you said. Very much enjoyed the presentation, very excited about the government's release of data. But when I'm talking to policymakers, politicians, and companies, I have to talk in really crude, simplistic terms about 2.5 categories of data. Okay? It's great to release data about things and finance and maps and stats. That's wonderful, and let's compute it. But government is just as delinquent about personal data and how it handles personal data. And I think that needs to be held in a quite distinct way and treated in a quite distinct way. And mm-hmm. It's important to frame that and what you're speaking about.
Mm-hmm.
And the extra half category is quite contentious, because this is the anonymized, or so-called anonymized data, often used for medical research and so forth, mm-hmm. which people have built successful businesses. And I think it's poorly understood the extent to which that can't really be anonymized. And I think there are risks.
Yes, okay.
So I fully accept what you said.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's a very important point, and I will add that to future discussions of this. In fact, I was just at a conference yesterday where this is mainly about telecoms, where this issue of privacy on the web is becoming it's kind of going right up the agenda correctly. Yeah, you're right. I mean, there's a big difference between sort of amalgamated, if that's the right word, data, where it's sort of homogenized between the groups that you're talking about to get results like I was showing, and very personal data that's held just to you. And I think there are all these ideas of, you know, data safes and things, but many of these can have mistakes made and things not happen. So, yeah, I completely agree that, in the end, one needs to set both technology up that's trustworthy, and one needs to kind of have people in charge of that that one kind of somewhat trusts, held together by a framework, probably a regulatory framework, actually, that sort of allows certain things to happen and not happen. But it's a complicated mix of trust, technology, and a regulatory framework that I think needs to be in place. And it is very important that as we get computers operating more on data and things, and and more data's out there, that we don't screw up as much as has happened in recent times. Yes. Gosh, a single word is pretty hard to summarize in, I think. I think we'd like to be, I mean, in terms of, we have two slightly distinct businesses, because we've got the Mathematica sort of base business, which incidentally the whole of Wolfram Alpha was built on, and that's sort of how we managed to do that. And we also have, this sort of knowledge business. I think we'd like to be in the middle of this knowledge ecosystem in a way that can sort of provide, in a sense, the glue between the knowledge providers and the users of that knowledge. So I suppose that's not one word, but perhaps a phrase. A couple of others. Okay, I'll take a couple more while we're trying to get our technology working. Yes. Yes. Fine. Sorry, I'm multitasking a little bit. So the question was, do we have a semantic model underneath the Wolfram Alpha? What we have is a symbolic function model. So the way roughly this works, and you'll hear more about this later, is that a query is taken from its linguistic form to a symbolic functional form. And similarly, the data is held in a form that, I mean, I'm way oversimplifying it here, but it's held in a form that also ends up as a symbolic function. And then essentially we're computing between those. So I think we're sort of, that's why I say we're sort of one step further than a semantic layer. And yes, there are layers of that, and in future those will be more easily uncovered. Some of those you can compute with right now, for example, in Mathematica by loading those in, but that'll be a much more tight connection. Because one of the interesting things here is the interface that you want depends a lot on what you're trying to do. If you're trying to get a drive-by answer, a linguistic interface is really helpful. If you're trying to write a very formal program, essentially, for something, you still need to speak the computer's language, at least for the time being. I mean, you know, to build an infrastructure system, you still need to do that. So the interface, I think, depends a lot on the style of what you're trying to achieve. Right, let me...